Good afternoon. Please rise as we join in singing our opening hymn, O Come All Ye Faithful, on page 357 in the red Spirited Songbook, page 357 in the red Gather Hymnal.
Justice, mercy, and love. Lord, bless this manger and all who look upon it. May it remind us of the humble birth of Jesus and raise up our thoughts to him, who is God with us and for us, and Savior of all, and who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen.
Jesus, your mighty God and Prince of Peace, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Lord Jesus, your Son of God and Son of Mary, Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord Jesus, your Word made flesh, the splendor of God, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us sing out and give glory to God. Mm-hmm.
Please join us on number 30 in our Blue Spirit Songbook, number 30.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. For Zion's sake, I will not be silent. For Jerusalem's sake, I will not be quiet until her vindication shines forth like the dawn and her victory like a burning torch. Nations shall behold your vindication and all the kings your glory. You shall be called by a new name pronounced by the mouth of the Lord. You shall be a glorious crown in the hand of the Lord, a royal diadem held by your God. No more shall people call you forsaken or your land desolate, but you shall be called my delight and your land espoused. For the Lord delights in you and makes your land his spouse. As a young man marries a virgin, your builder shall marry you. And as a bridegroom rejoices in his bride, so shall your God rejoice in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When Paul reached Antioch and Pisidia and entered the synagogue, he stood up, motioned with his hand, and said, "Fellow Israelites, and you others who are God-fearing, listen. The God of this people, Israel, chose our ancestors and exalted the people during their sojourn in the land of Egypt. With uplifted arm, he led them out of it. Then he removed Saul and raised up David as king. Of him he testified, 'I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will carry out my every wish. From this man's descendants, God, according to his promise, has brought to Israel a Savior, Jesus.' John heralded his coming by proclaiming a baptism of repentance to all the people of Israel. And as John was completing his course, he would say, 'What do you suppose that I am? I am not he. Behold, one is coming after me. I am not worthy to unfasten the sandals of his feet.'" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
She was found a child through the Holy Spirit. Joseph, her husband, since he was a righteous man, yet unwilling to expose her shame, decided to divorce her quietly. Such was his intention when, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary, your wife, into your home. For it is through the Holy Spirit this child has been conceived in her. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke, he did as the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and took his wife into his home. He had no relations with her until she bore a son, and he named him Jesus. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So, how do you think the church looks, huh? Beautiful?
Yep.
Those are the same when somebody goes for cheap applause, you know, really. I'm very grateful. Last Sunday night, we had way over 70 people here helping to put all this together. 24 Christmas trees, a couple of hundred poinsettia plants, and all kinds of other things. I'm telling you, it looked like total chaos. To see it now in this state is quite remarkable and quite refreshing. I've had the privilege of being the confirmation sponsor for almost all of my nieces and nephews. And a few years ago, I was confirmation sponsor for a particular nephew where the confirming bishop was Bishop Shelton Fobb. Some of you may not know him, but he was the auxiliary bishop of New Orleans for several years. He's now the bishop of Louisville, Kentucky. And he gave one of the most beautiful talks that I've ever heard given at a confirmation. And I want to share it with you tonight because I think it really relates to what we're celebrating at Christmas. Bishop Shelton said that when he was about 7 or 8 years old, his mom was the head of the food booth at their church fair. And as a little boy, he had to sit in the back of the booth on a stool for basically the entire day. His mother didn't trust to let him go around the fairgrounds. She was concerned for his safety. So he sat there and played from about 8 in the morning to about 2 in the afternoon. He said he was so bored playing with the few games that he had brought. At about 2 o'clock, the steady line for people getting food, hamburgers, hot dogs, and so forth, it kind of tapered off, and his mother looked at him and she said, "Shelton, you have been so amazing. I know you're bored to death, but you have not complained one time. And so I'm going to get you a very special treat from the redemption booth." That was the booth where people went after they accumulated tickets and points for various games. And he had already eyeballed it. And so over there they went, his mom holding his hand, and they walked over to the booth. And in front of him was some of the best toys he had ever seen in his life. Shiny toys, toys that made noises, some of the things that he really wanted. He just said he couldn't take it all in. And his mother went up to the counter and she made a transaction. She turned around and said, "Now I want you to close your eyes and hold out your hands, and I'm gonna put this very special thing that I've chosen for you in your hands." And so he held out his little hands and she put something in it that felt really strange. And she said, "Now open your eyes." And when he looked down, it was not a toy. It was a white plastic crucifix. He couldn't believe his mom found the only religious gift in the entire place. He looked at it and he said he was never so disappointed in all of his young years of life. And his mother looked at him and she was smiling and beaming and so excited. And she said, "I just knew you'd love it." And he said, "I really had to fake a thank you." And he said, "Thank you, Mom." And she was so overjoyed, she grabbed him by the hand as he held his little white crucifix. And as they walked away, he looked back at all the toys on the shelves that he was not getting. They went home later that night, and he went up to his room, and he put the white crucifix in his dresser drawer, in the sock drawer, and closed it. And there it sat for about a month. And about a month into this, his dad suddenly got very, very sick, and he had to go to the hospital. And his mom called him and his other siblings, and she said, "We need to pray for your father. He is really sick. And I want you to go to your room." They prayed together. "Go to your room, and you kneel down and pray." He went to his bedroom. He knelt down, and he remembered the crucifix. And pulled out this white plastic crucifix and put it on the dresser, and he knelt down before it, and in his little words of a 7 or 8 year old child said, "Oh Lord, please let my dad get well." And 2 days later, his dad was discharged from the hospital. He never did say what he had, but whatever he had, he was fine. And he came back home, and he had kept that crucifix out. But once his dad was well, he went back in the room and he put it back in the sock drawer. And several more months passed by. And his mom came one day and brought the children together and she said, "I need you to pray for your dad." She was crying. "We just found out today he lost his job. He was laid off. And that means we don't have any source of income." And she was very upset. And they prayed together. And then she said, "Your dad is upset. I want you to go to your room and kneel down and pray to God." He went to his room, went to the sock drawer, took out the white plastic crucifix, put it on his dresser, knelt down and prayed. And he kept praying every day. Because his dad did not get a job very quickly, a number of weeks passed, and he kept praying and kept pleading with God. And then one day his father came home with this incredible smile and the good news. He had not only gotten a job, but he had gotten a job paying a lot more money. And he remembers seeing his mom and dad do this little dance in the kitchen. They were so excited. And he went back to his room. He started to put that crucifix back in the sock drawer, but as he did, he noticed there was a nail on the wall. He never noticed it before, and he went and hung the crucifix on that nail. And he said, from that moment forward, something changed in him. And every time he needed something in his life, or every time he was struggling with something, or needed guidance, he would go kneel down in front of that crucifix and talk to Jesus. If he had a test coming up, he would talk to Jesus and pray. If there was something struggle going on in his family, if he had a conflict with somebody at school, whatever it was, he would go there and pray. And as he continued to grow older through elementary school and high school, that's where he prayed finally to discern that God was calling him to enter seminary and study to become a priest. And he ended up going off to Belgium, to Louvain Seminary, to study for the priesthood. And of course, he flew over there. He couldn't take many things, but he took the white plastic crucifix with him. And he continued to pray and continued to make it a part of his life as he became a priest and as the years began to roll by. And one day, the Pope's representative called him out of the blue and said, Is this Father Shelton Fromm? Yes. The Holy Father has appointed you the auxiliary bishop of New Orleans. And he froze. And he immediately got off the phone and went to look for the white plastic crucifix. And prayed and said, oh God, I never in a million years thought that you would ask me to do this. But I'm going to trust you in this. And from that moment forward, he said he put that crucifix in the greatest place of honor he could find in his home, which was right above his bed, in his bedroom. And he said that's where it remains. Now all these 11th grade confirmation students and their families and the kids, they're all like really listening to this story. And then he says to them, so what does this have to do with confirmation? What in the world? He said, some of you may be here tonight. You may have come here kicking and screaming. Maybe your mother or your grandmother kind of forced your hand into confirmation. Maybe you're not really impressed with getting the Holy Spirit at all. But I'm going to tell you, there will come a day in your life when you have to make a decision, when you need strength, when you need grace, when you're in a difficult trial, when you're going to call upon the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit's going to shower gifts upon you, and you're going to be very glad you came for this night of confirmation. And I would say the same thing as we celebrate Christmas. Christmas, we celebrate one of the greatest gifts that God ever gave us, the incarnation of his son Jesus in human flesh. God, who created everything there is, humbled himself to become human just like us so that we wouldn't have to suffer the pain of being separated from him forever because of our rebellion and our sin. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, God sent his son into this world as a human baby, a helpless, powerless human baby. The God of the universe intentionally became helpless and powerless so that he could experience the fullness of being human except for sin. Jesus came to reveal the immense love that God has for us and eventually to suffer and to die and to save us and redeem us from sin and the finality of death, not on a white plastic crucifix, but on a large, harsh, wooden crucifix depicted above the altar here today. Today we celebrate the great feast of our salvation, Christmas. A lot of people will get toys and games and very cool electronic things and wonderful gifts that will excite them for a short while. But material gifts are fleeting, and a few months from now, and certainly a year from now, probably won't remember what we got as a gift for last Christmas. It is the birth of our Lord Jesus in the flesh, which is the great gift of Christmas and a monumental occasion for rejoicing. Today we remember the real reason for the season, Emmanuel, a word which means God with us. Not God out there in space, not God some abstraction that we can't wrap our mind around or our heart around, God with us, permanently with us. Some people sometimes say to me, when's God just going to give up on us with all of our sin and selfishness? God's not going to give up on us. God has made a permanent, irrevocable commitment to us. We can walk away from God. God will not walk away from us. God married us on the cross with the saving grace of Jesus. Because God is with us always, we need to talk to God. We need to cry to God. We need to rejoice with the joys of our lives. And we certainly need to receive God sacramentally, because God is with us forever. And what greater gift than God could we possibly want? No wonder the angels sang out on the night Jesus was born, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. Father Andrew and I and our staff wish you a very blessed and Merry Christmas. And if this ever happens in your life, that someone offers you a choice between a crucifix and some really cool gift, you better take the crucifix and run with it. Amen. Please stand as we profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess my baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Trusting in God's immense love for us, we bring our prayers and needs to God, our Heavenly Father.
For a deeper indwelling of Jesus in our families, community, and nation, as we celebrate his birth into human flesh, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a peaceful resolution of the conflict in the Middle East, and for protection of civilian populations in war-torn areas, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Pope Francis' prayer intention for the month of December, that people living with disabilities may be at the center of attention in society, and that institutions may offer inclusive programs which value their active participation, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the people of China, Cuba, Iraq, Afghanistan, and Nicaragua, as they struggle in the face of persecution and violence, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For healing of all who are sick or suffering physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For vocations to the priesthood and religious life, especially here from our parish, and for the strengthening of marriages, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For blessings on our parishioners for their acts of service and support during the days of preparation for Christmas, including all who help with receptions, the giving tree, food distribution, decorating, flowers, and concerts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of our deceased loved ones, and for those whose names are listed in our Point 7 Memorial Board, living and deceased, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We now pause and have our own intentions in silence. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Please join now and say our family prayer on the inside front cover of the gathered hymnal. Following that prayer, we recite a Hail Mary for peace with Israel and Ukraine, and for the cause of life and godly values in our nation.
Loving and faithful God, through the years the people of our archdiocese have appreciated the prayers and love of our Lady of God's support in times of war, disaster, and epidemic illness. We come to you, Father, Mary, our mother, and ask you to help us to battle today against violence, murder, and racism. We implore you to give us your wisdom that we may build a community founded on the values of Jesus, which gives respect to life and dignity of all people. Bless parents that they may form their children in faith. Bless and protect our youth that they may be peacemakers of our time. Give consolation to those who lost loved ones through violence. Hear our prayer and give us perseverance to be a voice for life and human dignity in our community. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Our Lady of Promise, our Lord, hasten to help us. Mother Henrietta Leal, pray for us that we may be a holy family. And together we pray, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and the hour of our death. Amen. Heavenly Father, please hear the prayers we offer, which we make in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated as the ushers take up the collection for the expenses and ministries of our church, and as our servers prepare the altar for the sacred sacrifice.
Please join in singing our offertory hymn, O Little Town of Bethlehem, on page 359 in the Red Book, page 359.
Thank you.
pray, sisters and
brothers, that my sacrifice is yours, may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. As we look forward, O Lord, to the coming festivities, may we serve you all the more eagerly, for knowing that in them you make us manifest the beginnings of our redemption. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in the mystery of the Word made flesh, a new light of your glory has shone upon the eyes of our mind, so that as we recognize in Christ God made visible, we may be caught up through Christ in love of things not visible. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, and Gregory, our Bishop, and all the clergy, remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the Blessed Joseph, her spouse, the Blessed Apostles, and all the saints, including you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant our peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. For the distribution of communion today, we'll have two stations in the center aisle. There'll also be two additional stations at the midway point of the center aisle. There'll be stations on either side, and if you wish to receive from the cup the blood of Christ, that will be offered in the front on both sides.
Body of Christ.
Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we pray, that we may draw new vigor from celebrating the nativity of your only begotten Son, by whose heavenly mystery we receive both food and drink, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated briefly for just a few announcements. For anyone who may ask you, the remaining Masses are at 6 p.m. tonight and tomorrow, 8, 10, and 12. Next weekend, the Feast of the Holy Family is the regular Mass schedule with one change. Instead of a 6 o'clock Sunday evening Mass, the Mass will be at 4 o'clock Sunday afternoon because of New Year's Eve. We will kick off the 100th anniversary of St. Francis Xavier Parish on Monday, January 1st. This parish was founded on January 1st, 1924, so we will celebrate our 100th anniversary in just a few days. We have a number of wonderful anniversary events scheduled during the whole year, but the kickoff celebration will be a Mass at 10 a.m. on Monday, January 1st. We will have our choirs, adult and children. We'll have cake, champagne, how about that? And the blessing of a beautiful bronze anniversary plaque, which will be on the front wall of the new church. We hope you can join us. Our church office and chapel are closed for the holidays and will reopen on January 2nd. We have a Christmas gift for you as you leave today. This book called Beautiful Eucharist. It's 12 essays written by people who talk about their experience with the Holy Eucharist. My favorite one was the first. It's entitled, Mass Was Boring Until This Happened. And doesn't that pique your interest? We have one of these for every household, so please take this. It's a great book by Matthew Kelly, In the Year of the Eucharist. And for children, we have M&M Candy Canes. Adults do not walk, squat, and look like children leaving church. But we do have a bunch of these, so we'll be generous giving them out. I hope you enjoy that as a sign of our blessing to you. We thank everyone who helped prepare our community celebrations, both for Advent and Christmas, including those who served and prepared our Masses. We want to thank our lectors. We want to thank our Eucharistic ministers, our altar servers, our sacristans, our ushers, the people who decorated the altar, our hospitality ministers, deacons, and staff. And how about a shout out for our children's choir, huh? How did they do? As you leave church today, we invite you to check out the Poinsettia Memorial Board. We have a list of all the people, living and deceased, whom we're praying for at all the Masses in the three big Christmas season. We also invite you to look at our historic nativity set, which was constructed in the 1950s, and is a beautiful reminder of the era gone by. And finally, we invite you, if you haven't been to the church recently and seen all the decorative paint and touches that we've added, we invite you to take a picture with your family on the altar that takes in some of the new beauty in the church and the Christmas decorations as well. And finally, for that Andrew and I and our deacons and our staff wish you and your loved ones a very blessed, very joyous, very Merry Christmas. Amen. Please stand for the final blessing. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God. Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray, and do thou, the Prince of the Heavenly Hosts, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking to ruin the souls. Amen.
Will you join in singing our recessional hymn, We Wish You a Merry Christmas?
Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas.